want to see. We all want to be real. And we're searching.
Hello.
Hello.
We made it through the difficulty of the new technology. Now to the fun part, the actual interview.
Oh man. Well, we just got hit with a commissine, which is a major windstorm here.
Yeah, so we had to close every
we had to run around and close every door, every window.
Oh, okay. Well, wonderful. Well, welcome. We're now together. That's beautiful. And we're also welcoming, of course, our listeners. Tonight, as usual, we are honored to be your hosts, Christina and Stefan. And we have a lot of prepared for today's show. We're very excited and waited quite a bit for you guys to be able to come on again. So today we're going to have two very special guests that we had before. Patricia and Yousef Awyan, and both beautiful people, a beautiful couple, researchers, Khemitologists. They both live near the Giza Plateau, if you don't know that, in Cairo. They lead phenomenal Khemitology tours annually. They travel and research and work with Syncretism, uniting the past and the future in this present for us, showing us that there is, you know, so many stories to be told other than what the mainstream media is telling us, what education and the cultural evolution in general. And just quickly, for the listeners that haven't listened to our previous show with them, Patricia is a Khemit School co-director, researcher, speaker, explorer, artist, spiritual, intuitive, life counselor. Patricia devotes much of her time to the study and exploration of ancient mysteries, symbolism, and mythologies worldwide. She's traveled to the sites in Australia, Great Britain, France, Spain, Lebanon, Peru, Bolivia, all over the Americas, and Egypt, of course, researching the clues that support the concept of a very advanced civilization, technologically and spiritually, that once spanned the globe, possibly tens of thousands of years ago, and left us this legacy of knowledge and wisdom for us to decipher. And, of course, Yousef is here as well. He's one of the sons of the infamous and well-respected ancient Khemitian wisdom keeper, Hakim Abdel Awyan. And Yousef is also a stonemason, musician, a tour guide, and an artist. Yousef reads and interprets the hieroglyphs, symbols, and images found in Egypt from a unique perspective as taught to him by his father, as well as through his own research and continual studies that we, of course, follow all the time on YouTube. As an accomplished musician, Yousef's keen ear for sound, frequencies, and pitch enable him to tune in and find the resonant tones in many of these sacred areas and chambers and monuments and temples throughout Egypt. So the amount of passion and love that these people put into the work and study is really commendable and unbelievably beautiful. We're so lucky to have you guys, and the energy of wisdom and knowledge inspires and awakes so many people all around the world, and we're so very thankful that you're here with us again today.
Yeah, and also we would love to give the links to the works they do. It's the khemitology.com. You can go and find many articles, many information about upcoming tours, and you know, also you can find them in YouTube, which is Khemit and Ology. So that's really, really phenomenal. And also you can share our, and you also find our previous shows with them in our YouTube channel, which is OpThinkTeam, and show with Yousef Awyan and show with Patricia Awyan. So thank you once again for joining. Maybe you would love to share some current works of yours and maybe some nearest future plans, and we know that you are having some many tours which are in the nearest future.
First, thank you for having us. We're really happy to be here.
Thank you for having us, and thank you for everything you said. I want to talk about myself this group.
Well, we're excited to announce that we do have lots of tour experiences coming up. In the very near future, we have the Techno Spiritual Tour in April.
Yeah. And we've been doing this tour. It became now like the main tour of the Khemit school, the techno-spiritual tour. And this is the fourth.
Yeah, this will be tech. Yeah, four.
Yes.
Featuring Stephen Mailer, Brian Foster, Susan Moore,
yeah.
And the three of us.
Me and Patricia and Muhammad Ibrahim, of course. Plus, we always have the company of our audiovisual team. It's Beatrice and Sadat. They cover all the photos and videos and stuff. So, there is always new things. No matter how much you know in this field, you can be surprised by new things all the time. Sometimes these things can be brought to our attention or to our sight by one of our guests. Just when they open up that it's a mystery, that not everything is figured out, as some people would try to talk like as if everything is figured out, then they start to open up their awareness to look around with us and see more evidence of the lost technology or even like normal Egyptology things like symbols or words or scenes on the walls. So the field is very rich, and that's what keeps the passion going all the time.
Yeah, that's what's really phenomenal about the work you do, is like you're connecting people and you are letting the people who are not very, you know, very sophisticated in the area of archaeology, of the research, just to see things and participate and find from the different angle of view and find together things. That's really phenomenal.
Yeah. With the help of the other speakers.
Yeah.
Because, you know, for example, Stephen Miller, he worked in archaeology for many, many years. And, of course, the geology subject is very, very important, because we see all kinds of, like, many, many kinds of different types of stones. So,
which has,
Susan Moore,
profound meaning on many levels.
And also other two was Dr. Robert Chuck. He's also worldwide famous geologist. And we learn a lot from both of them, from Robert and from Susan.
So, yes, we'll be working with Robert in May. That's coming up really quickly after April. And then we're excited to announce we'll be working with Andrew Collins and Hugh Newman in September of Megalithomania. So we have a lot of things on the schedule coming up.
Yeah.
As
Dr.
well
Robert
as,
Chuck,
yeah.
Of course, his research is famous, worldwide famous. He did all kinds of tests in the Sphinx enclosure and also in the bedrock itself of limestone and like Neolithic formations with fossils and stuff like that.
Hmm.
So, yeah.
Really
it's great.
Yeah.
Us to hear each other and learn more.
Exactly. It's really beautiful to see this, you know, syncretistic approach where you know, old knowledge and new knowledge comes together and outcomes what we hear from you. But maybe a more generalized question, how do you feel since you've been doing this and since this has kind of somewhat exploded in the social media and whatnot, how is the worldview changing towards archaeology? Are people starting to wake up? Are also authorities maybe partially having to admit certain things that were taboo not too long ago? What is your view on things like that?
Well, everything is absolutely changing today. Now, you mentioned archaeology. Archaeology is a field that it's really almost, you know, a science. And this field is totally ruled by the academic standards. Egyptology, also academic, but we do see, you know, it's really hard. You know, the reason Hakim and Stephen Mailer came up with the term or the concept of khematology is to address the alternative understanding of what is found here in Egypt. And I think, you know, the alternative groups, the people that are willing to look a little further, are waking up all over the world. And, you know, we mentioned the people we're working with. You know, Brian Foster is well known for doing the same kind of work in Peru and Bolivia. And there are people all over the world that are investigating a little deeper without having the academic constraints to keep them from presenting their information to the public. And so the public is awakening. However, there's a lot of, you know, what we see is there's so many stories that are not true running around. And I think there's a call for discernment and really taking a closer look, you know, at what you're, you know, people really need to look deeper themselves and not just accept everything they hear as well.
Usually what's on the bottom, of course, is the oldest. What's on the top is the newest. But there's been shifts. But how Hakim would do it, how my research partner Bob Water and I say, Hakim's teaching was like pulling away the layers of it. You have the surface layer here, which is your current Islamic, Egyptian, Arab, I put in quotes, layer. Then you peel away that layer, you have a Coptic Christian layer. You peel away that layer, you have a Roman layer. You peel away that layer, you have a Greek layer. You peel it that way, layer, and you have a Jewish level, which only Hakim taught. You pull away the Jewish layer, and you have what we call dynastic Egypt. And this is what Egyptology recognizes as ancient Egypt. Just dynastic, up to zero. Up to dynasty zero. But after you pull away the dynastic layer, there is ancient Khemit. And we don't really have to excavate it, because here it is right behind you. There it is over there. There it is when we go to divinity. So there it is. So we say, as Yousef coined this phrase, site transformation. Each group that came in added their imprint to what was there, even the dynastic people themselves. Every pyramid, every temple you will see, especially in the so-called dynastic period, has a foundation stone from an ancient Phoenician temple. They believed these things were organic beings. That they didn't differentiate between inorganic and organic as we do. Everything had spirit, everything had consciousness. So when they created an edifice, a temple, a pyramid, they believed they infused life force into it. And it was conscious, so that they would take a seed from a previous temple to plant the seed for the new temple. So wherever you go, we will look, as Yousef is a genius, three stones, rose quartz, basalt, calcite. That is ancient Khemit. That was not dynastic stones. They did not work in those stones. So you'll see things brought. You'll see, like we go to Karnak, you'll see a great alabaster altar as soon as we come in. That's there. From there, that was taken from an ancient Phoenician temple. Always taking things from the old and putting in the new. They did it throughout the 4,000 years of this civilization. Always taking from the old, putting into the new. So what we talk about is site transformation. All that came in, the Greeks, the Romans, everybody, the dynastic transformed. And this is why we say you cannot date the sites by what is written. Because the writing could be thousands and thousands of years later. We'll prove it in the Soviet Union. We'll prove it in many places. We'll show you. The writing is crude compared to the incredible technology.
Yeah. I also want to tell you something. Lots of the mysteries, most of the mysteries, is recognized by the officials. And the explanation sometimes is what, like, not satisfying, you know? Especially when it comes to machine, because we see results of very accurate work, precision, everything, you know, it talks its language, the structure or the artifacts. And something like, especially the power tools marking, tubular drills and circular stones, things like that, or the interlocking stones, for example. So they can have one answer for it. And most of the time, or all the time, the answer will be based on imagining that those who built it were, how to do it easy, or how can it be done primitively. But nobody thought of other things. And that's where the other researchers now come in, because we're trying to find the truth. We understand how hard the stone can be shaped manually, and everything with hand tools. But there are other things, like these other types of machining, that exists in the vessels and in the pyramid structures. And it's still unknown. Even the depictions on the walls, they show something else. They show process of manufacturing something, but the tools they're using is not the same tools that actually created or manufactured these pieces. So they sometimes or most of the time recognize something, some mystery, some question marks, and the theory is not satisfying anybody who wants to really look into this, especially because most of it was made by historians and not engineers. So engineers, like, of course, Christopher Dunn is the best example I learned from and had the honor to tour with. And the way he sees this so clearly, especially around the quarry in Aswan. And, for example, at the quarry of Aswan, we can find different types of machinery. Some are recognized and some are not understood. So based on that, they made up or like they thought of a theory based on the pounders that they found on the place. And they made a theory that this was being hacked by crushing the granite stone with these pounders. And this, for example, one theory that Christopher Dunn doesn't agree with, and he thinks it's a really ridiculous thing, and I agree with him on this. And the pounders are not just found in the quarry, it is also found in the sites that was used as a quarry. So we know that using this techniques by pounding on the stone was not the one that created the results around the unfinished obelisk, a couple of them in the quarry. And we know that it is the primitive style that was used by making pits in the stone and then put wood and pour water for the wood to expand and the stone to be cracked. So the mistake here, in my opinion, happened because the person who wanted to find the answer didn't realize or didn't put in his mind like how the eras come up on each other like a succession of ages. So that one thing that can create mistakes. And sometimes, like, items were usurped by other kings, and they recognized this, and they write it down also. So it's not that like they don't know, but there is a bigger picture of this. It can be much more. It can be much more than just the examples. And it's good that they found the examples. Like, officially, for example, the Giza Plateau was used as a quarry in the Middle Kingdom. And that's around 2100 BC, between 2100 BC and 1700 BC, according to the official timelines. But it's the era right after the first intermediate period, supposedly, of the era of the Old Kingdom, where the pyramid builders exist. And we see evidence of an old kingdom recycling of stone. So it just keeps going. Maybe there are more than the intermediate periods we know. Maybe the timeline of the civilization itself extends. And this is also, I wouldn't say approved, but also supported by the search or the research of geologists like Robert Shaw. It's a different way to date sites, and he recognized this, and he wouldn't date it less than 9700 BC, as far as I remember. So that's a timeline that you wouldn't find it in the official books. Nobody's going to talk about this timeline for the Sphinx enclosure. But based on his knowledge, in my opinion, he can recognize more than just translating writings, because we know that translating writings is not the accurate 100% source to date and relate artifacts and sites. Because they can be added and they were added in many different eras. So why not older? So why not even older?
Yeah, and what I really resonate is like you always encourage you and all the Khemitology school just to go to travel yourself and visit places and also feel the energy and be there, not only, you know, see images and stuff, but also go there. So what maybe are your intakes about the Göbekli Tepe or Gunung Padang in Indonesia, what they are finding, and maybe you have some plans maybe to visit them as well and do some investigation there on those sites too?
Well, we certainly hope to in the future. Turkey isn't exactly, well, may not be the place to go in this very moment, but certainly one of the places that the Khemit team has looked at, as well as many sites all over the world, of course. There's so many things being found everywhere, and of course we're staying on top of it, and it's always better to actually be at these sites before you formulate an opinion.
Yeah. And you, Patricia, just recently been in India tour, and maybe you can share some impressions, your findings of syncretism. Also, you shared some beautiful articles, so maybe you can elaborate what people you met there, and maybe you have some future plans with collaboration and working with them.
Oh, we absolutely do, and thank you. Yes, I was, strangely enough, I wasn't excited about going. India was never on the top of my list. I wanted to go. But when I got there, I was totally overwhelmed and blown away and so excited by what I found. And yes, synchronicities, syncretism, within the symbolism, of course, I find this worldwide. Most of the symbolism that I've come across worldwide is all speaking to the same, you know, the same, explaining the nature of our reality, basically, and how we come and breathe into and out of being. Beingness. But in India, what I found were, you know, there's the Vedic texts, which are so, what I find within the people that I spoke with about it, there's so much information that mirrors the work that I'm doing in Egypt to a much greater degree than anywhere else that I've found. So I needless to say, I was super excited. And then the structure of the buildings themselves, yes, also patterned very similarly, you know, the structures look entirely different to the eye, but mm-hmm. the patterning of the structures and how they place the symbolism was very, very similar to what we find here.
Yeah,
and in Egypt. Yeah. And the people, that, excuse me, yes.
Yeah, sorry. Just go on.
Well, I was just going to say, and yes, we were lucky to go with a friend of ours. Her name is Nantara. She had come with us to a trip to Baalbek in Lebanon last year. She invited me to come, and she put together a beautiful experience and brought in many experts from all fields of study. And it was really amazing to discover not only their wealth of knowledge, but that even in the academic fields, they were open to knowing and learning more. So a little bit, you know, similar to what we were just talking about. You had also mentioned, you know, the similarities in the structure as well with the alignments to stellar and solar events. I was amazed at, you know, it's just so funny when you see something that looks entirely different, yet all the same puzzle pieces come together to show a picture that is exactly the same. And that also includes the alchemy, the understanding of alchemy, and how you need to look at our reality from every aspect. You know, we tend to divide our study, our field of study into separate fields, biology, physics, mathematics, sacred geometry. And alchemy itself is when you combine these fields, you have a total understanding that in each and every one of these fields gives you the same, you know, it's the same understanding. It's all fractal. It's all telling you the same story. And so you need to actually understand it from every single perspective from all of these fields. And this is basically what the alchemy of the Netters here in Egypt, the Netters being the gods and goddesses, this is what they represent. It's the alchemy of the nature of our reality.
Yeah, and by learning by them, we can shape our presence. Like also in article of yours, they were very nicely expressed the similarities between the Sekhem, you know, goddess, and the Shakti in India. So like those two ones, and you said that as Kali, Shakti will appear at the end of the Kali Yuga, and Kali Yuga is the Yuga cycle, the metal age of that, when our consciousness is falling, and she will come to remove the debris of spirituality, dead humanity, in order to usher in a new cycle of light and peace. And you also said that the Egyptian nether segment embodies this aspect as the divine mother principle, as the fierce rays of flares of the sun, and that ultimately restore balance for the resultant volcanoes, earthquakes, and shifts. So also we see that today in our society, how the energy is shifting, not only the, you know, in physical way, but energetically what we are seeing now, you know, all those things which are happening. So we just can learn from those myths and...
Yeah, it actually, it explains just about every cycle and cycle within cycle. When you consider how you make changes in your own life, you begin by seeing the patterns that are out of balance. And, you know, in order to make a change or go move into a new, you know, a new cycle of being, you have to break those patterns. And how do we break them? It's destruction. You know, you break them, you tear them apart so that you can build something entirely new. And that's the same thing that we're talking about, these eternal cycles where we have this moment of complete knowing, I call it gnosis, and then we come out of that with all this wonderful knowledge, but we have this devolving consciousness, and then we fall into this field of separation, the Kali Yuga, as you mentioned, or in Egypt they call it the cycle of Amen. This is the night cycle. And then as you come out of that, you know, in order to break that cycle, there has to be this fierce destructive, and Sekhmet actually represents those fierce destructive rays of the sun, which actually affects the earth's vibration and therefore causes these volcanoes. This is like even the plasma events that Dr. Robert Schock speaks about, or, you know, the big solar flares that we speak about, these affect the earth's vibration. And so, yes, this is the volcanoes and the earthquakes, and, you know, this is what needs to happen in order for the earth to heal and then begin again, a new cycle, you know, a new beginning and a new, you know, a whole new field of energy after a great healing, which is the story of Sekhmet and Ptah and Nefertum.
Yeah, indeed. And also not only in physical ways that, you know, just manifest, but also in energetical and in the... theological as well. Like we see recently, we just see all of people are talking about the flat earth agenda and, you know, that earth is flat and lots of those topics and that.
I find it almost...
Yeah, go on.
Oh, no, it's okay. I was just going to say flat earth is a really interesting topic and I have a very unconventional way of looking at it. Because I find when you consider dimensionality and how we move through, you know, there's many vibrations of beingness. And so when you consider flat earth and three-dimensional earth, you know, the sphere, you know, is it not probable or possible that every dimension of the earth exists? There is a flat earth. There is a spherical earth. And we exist in higher dimensionality as well. And it's this big flat earth agenda trying to bring us back to this two-dimensional way of looking at ourselves. Maybe.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and also related to the feminine as well, because, you know, the all of the cultures around the world are talking that Earth is mother, is the female. So, again, we're just trying to distract ourselves from that bond of mother and, again, just go to the other direction. So it's kind of very tricky.
I agree with you totally. I agree. You know, this right now we live in a patriarchal, I call it Northern Hemisphere perspective. And, you know, here in Egypt, we always consider, you know, we know that if you're looking at the topography of Egypt, south is up. We call Upper Egypt is the south and Lower Egypt is the north. And we know that the Temple of Isis, the throne of Egypt, Nubia, is in Nubia. It's in the south. And this is the gold. This is, you know, this is the throne. This is the seat. And south is up. The Nile River flows up. It's the only major river in the world that flows north. And it makes you wonder, you know, consider right now that people tell us we're in the age of Aquarius. But this comes from a Northern Hemisphere perspective. We're all looking up. Okay, what if we were on the South Pole right now? right now, we would be, if we were looking at a South Pole perspective, we would be in the age of Leo. That changes everything, doesn't it? Yeah. If we could just change our perspective from patriarchal to matriarchal, it could change the entire patterning of the nature of our reality right here on the planet.
Yeah, indeed. It's also very interesting, like you did the investigation in Dendera temple and what maybe are the plot for nearest future according to ancient cycles and prophecies on the temples in Dendera.
Well, the temple itself is, you know, it's funny. We always take our guests through the first gate and we tell them to look up because it's really the only place in Egypt that they see that you will look at the underbelly of the winged scarab. And Hakim would always say that this is because this you're entering a place that holds all the secrets. And he was absolutely right, in my opinion, because the structure itself at Dendera, the structure, the architecture, the temple is speaking. It's telling you a story. And then you walk into the first floor and it tells you, it gives you the nature of the cycles and cycles within cycles. It tells a story of our journey through these cycles, but it tells it in two dimensions. But then you move up through the temple and you go to the second floor. And when you go up, you spiral up. You have to go up a spiral staircase. So you're springing up, okay? And when you get up there, you see the Dendera zodiac, which is the same story in a more simplified, much smaller area, but it's in three dimensions. It spirals, and it's showing the breath of life. The same story spiraling back and forth, involving and evolving. So it's really exciting. And then when you come back down again to the first level, it's straight down. You fall back into the night cycle. And you move up on the day side and you spring down on the night side. So, you know, and that's just a very simplified, you know, one aspect of what you'll find within this temple.
Actually, what you're looking at, there's, as we said, are cycles within cycles within cycles, and the ceiling is telling the story of several cycles. So first I'll mention the daily cycle. So what you're looking at, if you see all the way on the other end, on the ceiling in the corner, you see the face of Nut and her hands. Notice the stars and the image between her hands. Remember I said the negative space holds imagery as well? It's the sycamore tree. You see it? In between her hands. All right, this is Nut, this is the sky. Okay, so you go through, see her body is all energy and stars. These are the nurturing nipples of the stars, the sky. We are being fed by the stars. Okay, so in the morning, she gives birth to the sun on a day cycle. And here the sun is expressed, the energy rays come down, and what you see underneath his face, which is Hathor, is a shrine, and you can even see that it shows you the polarity of the shrine itself. See the white checks and the gray checks and then the black and gray checks. So there is your negative and positive giving birth to the manifested physical face. The face of Hathor is the seed. It's us, it's the face of humanity, okay? That's who she is. She is all humanity, but she is the divine feminine. She is the womb that gives birth to the seed, the alpha, the omega. I am all that is, was, and ever shall be. So you can see it's the manifestation of the physical world on the great year cycle, on the day cycle, and the yearly cycle. But now we're gonna take a look at the astrology that you're seeing in just the annual cycle. If you look, you continue down past the face, what you see coming out of her legs, look at her the leg on the left. Do you see the image that is, it's not raised, it's imprinted, and that's the crab or the scarab, both representing Cancer. So we're moving out of Cancer, we are birthed into the physical, and this is on a great year in the age of Taurus, which rules the material desires, the physical desires. So do you see the crab? Okay. The scarab. I say crab or scarab because they both represent him. It's our scarab people. And guess what? He has no wings. So we've fallen out of the age of Leo, and now we become, we start the process of creating our hologram again. And so we work down through the Milky Way, and next you see the twins, the Gemini twins. And they are represented, see them? Right above us.
That's Pollux and Kestner.
Shu and Tefnut. Okay, and Shu and Tefnut, as I mentioned before, is air and mist, water, the atmosphere that separates the earth and the sky. So right here above my head, they're holding hands. She is the lioness form, the divine feminine, and he has the single reed or feather on his head. He's air, she is mist, water, but they're the electromagnetic energy, electricity and magnetics of the atom that create the spark of life. So as we move from Gemini, we move right into the age of Taurus. This is where we literally fall into the dense material state. Okay, and that's represented by the bull. So we can keep walking down, and you see Aries, the ram. See him? Now, there's a story being told as we go, and you can study this symbolism. Someday I want to come and stay in the village and just bring a mattress and look at the images, because you need to feel them as they are. I think sometimes to fully understand them. So we move from the ram, and you can see Pisces, which is fish, around the sacred lake of energy. So this is the age of Pisces, when Christ or Horus is born, the sun S-O-N, the sun S-U-N. Okay, so this is the birth or the beginning of a new awakening, but we're still seeds. We've been sparked into life. And so we move further, and she now swallows the sun again on the daily cycle. Only on the daily cycle, because we have to complete our year on the other side of the temple. So this is one side. This is the night side of the temple. As I said, we fell into the physical, so we are on the masculine side of the temple. Now we're going to go over to the feminine side, the other side of the yearly cycle and the great year cycle. Again, we begin with here's Capricorn, okay, and Sagittarius. Now what happens between December and January? We have the December solstice, all right, which is it's the time when the sun goes down to its lowest point in a yearly cycle, has its 3 days of rest, and begins again. But on a great year cycle, it could mean something totally different. What's really fascinating, and I'm going to talk about this in the lecture that we haven't gotten to yet, this is Tauret. She is the hippo. She's the great-grandmother. And she's holding the sa. And those of you that were with us yesterday with Muhammad, we showed you the sa symbol, and I related it to the analemma, which I'm going to show you in the lecture. And it's a diagram that they use in alchemy that shows how the sun creates the infinity symbol, with the day cycle being at the top and very small, the pot of gold, and then falling into the horizon into the night cycle. And what you're seeing her hold, see, she's got a lasso around the leg of the bull. And there is some contention with others. I've been debating with Wayne Herschel on Facebook. He believes this bull with the seven stars is the Pleiades. And I say that's a fractal mirror reflection, that this is actually the Big Dipper. This is the portal of our Taurus field of Earth, our vortex. It's the mouth where we are born into the physical and we rise through the spiritual. Always at the poles, of course. It's the vortex. And I'll show you again why I believe the catastrophe is cyclical. And it happens during these points. And she is holding on like a lasso. And if you count how many circles, we're looking at five stages, five cycles. The same five cycles of consciousness. So do we circle around for five times, and then does the axis go? And then come back up again. Because she's holding on. The analemma goes away when the axis is straight up and down, when we're in perfection 360 days. It disappears. It becomes one point in the sky. And then when we fall off our axis, is when we start to see the analemma form, which is what her device that she's holding on the ground, it's the birth of the physical that only can happen when we fall off our axis. Otherwise, we're in a state of perfection, gnosis, knowing, we know all. So then we move, you can see on a yearly cycle, we move into Sagittarius. You see Scorpio. You see Libra, there's the scales, balance, so we find balance. And then Virgo just happens to be in this area that's been locked up. Okay, this is another important area because you're talking September, between September and August, which is our autumnal equinox. So it's another pivot point within the cycle or circle. But what's really fascinating, and you can again see that we have cycles being denoted there within the box, the place of cycles. We move into the age of Leo, and you see what we've talked about since the beginning of the tour, the winged scarab. Newt or Mut now gives birth to the new beginning in the age of Leo. This is your moment of gnosis. And you can see the lion right there floating into her womb where she gives birth to the scarab. So right back to where we started, on the other side, the full cycle, the scarab had no wings when you're born into the night, and in the day, it's born with the wings and we fly into the light, always in the age of Leo, on either the yearly cycle or the great year cycle. Again, this is just a symbolic representation of the path of consciousness, your own journey through lower and higher consciousness within. This can all be replicated in the sine wave that I showed you of Adam Kadmon. Mm-hmm. This is our journey, our alchemical journey that we take as represented in a reflection outside ourselves. So I want to show you one last image. Display for us that we know that this is a reflection of what's happening within. Take a look up and we see the stairway that continues up. This is the stand that holds the mirror, but it's the sun that is the mirror. So when you look at the sun, you're looking at what? The eye. You're looking at me, your reflection. This is your journey, your story. Everything you see on this ceiling is what's happening within each one of us. So when you look at your outer world, and it's saying what you see on the ceiling is a reflection of the inner journey of consciousness, your consciousness moving through the stages back to wholeness, oneness, balance, or knowing, complete gnosis.
Yeah, very interesting. And that brings to another topic we just love to cover, because recently we just experienced the solar eclipse on the March 9th, you know, and, you know, we see that would be very interesting to ask about the meaning of the eclipses in Khemitian mythology and how energy was used in temples and acoustic way also in healing ways to the ecliptical times, you know, how stone could have, you know, in some possible ways reacted to the eclipse energy of nature.
Well, you know, it's funny, to be honest with you, Christina. I discovered more information about the eclipse events and their importance in India than what I've found so far in Egypt. You see it in the symbolism. Now, I do find correlations, and I have much to research now, but they do look to these eclipse periods as very significant events. But the energy of them differs depending on where you're at within the cycle, where the stars are in the sky. So each event would be significantly different. But the energy of what's happening itself, of course, is worldwide. When you're bringing these two entities, your day and night, your moon and your sun, together for that brief moment, you know, that brief time, it is, you know, that sacred union, that coming together. And it's a powerful moment. As my friend Lisbeth in India said, in that moment, if you were to speak a mantra, or as we would say, give out a heartfelt intention, it would be intensified by 100,000 times is the word she used. And I thought, wow, that's huge. So of course, this is a significant time or a powerful moment that can be utilized with ceremony or ritual if you're aware of you know, all the other aspects involved.
Yeah. Also, now a very interesting thing just to ask here is like Temple and Dendera, and we see that zodiac there, and we see that Cancer is not, you know, following that line. It just shows like something happened that Cancer just was moved from that place, and Cancer is Moon. So maybe that is also showing, like Yousef always talks about the hieroglyphs, and that temples are and stone and megaliths are much, much older than the hieroglyphs. So maybe they were telling the story how, you know, there are some theories that Moon is artificial. It was brought here by some of the events. So maybe that was story told when Moon wasn't here. So temple was quite older.
If you believe that the Moon really exists, or are we experiencing a hologram? And both in Egypt and in India, they call it Maya. The fact that our world is not what we think it is. It's an illusion. You know, it's a holographic illusion. If you understand how we even experience this reality, our material world, it's through our limited senses, these 5-6 senses that we are aware that we have. And even how that's physically studied, you know, we're not even seeing, you know, when you see an image, it's being flipped. And then if you think you're seeing blue, it's actually the reflection of yellow. So if you get what I mean, when you consider, well, let's get back to what you started with. You said it began with Cancer. It's sort of like the scarab coming out of her leg. And what that actually represents, based on what I've studied and the cycles has been given to us by the indigenous here, is the cycle begins in the age of basically you start with Un, and this Un, this noon, the shadowless consciousness, is a moment of no time and no space. Okay? And it's a time when we had no need for written or oral language, because this is a time when you feel, you understand, you have full use of 360 senses. So you understand, you feel what's happening. But this is the age, this is happening in the age, according to, you know, the dynamic of the age of Leo. And as we start to leave Leo is when we move into Gemini, this division. And then it's the first division. This is when they say we have the birth, the atom, because Un becomes atom, the first atom. And the atom, within the atom, you have Shu and Tefnut, which are like electricity and magnetism, the spark that opens the atom and creates this hologram, which starts in the age of Cancer. And this is why you see the calendars, both on the first floor in the hypostyle hall and on the second floor, both begin with Cancer, because this is the first moment that we define space and time through the cycles, the circle.
Hmm. And then, of course, we have the popular myth of Osiris, you know, the netter set symbolizing sunset, and how he's jealous of his favorite brother and sets out to kill him and eventually cuts him into, well, first it was 42 pieces, and then later telling it's only 14 pieces, and scatters them all throughout Khemit. And this occurs when the sun sets, you know, obviously that's a picture there, and we fall into the hidden cycle of Amun.
Yes, both relating to cycles and mm-hmm. to the land. Oops. I'm sorry, I lost you for a minute. I thought you stopped.
Yeah, that's fine. I mean, yeah, I was just going to give it over to you here with the cycle of Amun, you know, but also I wanted to say the 42 pieces represent the gnomes, you know, or divisions of the land of Egypt, and the original 42 tribes, of course. And, you know, if you look at it a little bit, you could also see a possible correlation to the myth of the Babel Tower, you know, the Tower of Babel, where that miscommunication and division kind of, you know, the night of humanity, so to speak, and then everybody goes their own ways, and we have to bring the pieces together. What do you think about that connection?
I actually totally agree with you on that, because as you did describe that, yes, Osiris, you know, being cut into the 42 pieces is representative of this falling into that dark night cycle when we're out of Mat balance. And yes, it's a time of separation, as you had said. And this is, of course, what I had just said, that, you know, we now have to utilize, you know, language in order to communicate, you know, written and oral. And the same, you know, that is the same story almost as Babel is, you know, this is now a time when, you know, all of a sudden nobody's speaking the same language. And yeah, it's all about separation, which is kind of where we're at today, you know, that we're being actually almost controlled. We are contained or held hostage through our separation, through fear and anger agendas, you know, through race, religious and political debate, you know, and this is what keeps us literally at each other's throats.
Yeah.
Well, I'm returning back to the subject of Dendera Temple. As we know how impressive this structure is. And let our audience hear from us this, that a beautiful structure like Dendera Temple, or like the first part of city, first temple in Abydos. These were all constructed during the dynastic Egyptians. But when we talk about a possibility of structures from a different era, from a much more ancient era, we're talking especially about the pyramids structures. And some of the structures are built above or with the same stone sometimes of much older structures. And also take Dendera Temple as one of these good examples. The site as it exists today, this is the latest, almost the latest layer on the place. But archaeologists and Egyptologists are aware that this site had from the pre-dynastic and from the old kingdom and the Middle Kingdom and the New Kingdom, throughout the ages, all the era lived in that place, until the Coptic time. Also in the Coptic time, they recycled some of the stones of the temple to build the church on the same site. But we can recognize sometimes that there was an ancient structure built by the pyramid builders. If we looked also at the leftovers of the stones and the combination of the stones in the place, even if it was reshaped and recycled more than once sometimes. But definitely the poor type of sandstone is one of the dynastic Egyptians' work. It's much softer than even the limestone used in the pyramid here or in some other structures also. But you need to put in your mind that the dynastic Egyptians developed amazing skill in constructing and in astronomy and the medicine and all this stuff. We definitely give credits. The mystery is truly in the pyramid builders. The mystery of the possible pre-cataclysm civilization, or the possibility of older timeline for the Egyptian civilization itself. So even with the cataclysm, it can still be the same civilization. And that's because we do find some of the artifacts, as we said before, like statues and like the vessels especially. Let me tell you a little bit about these vessels, if you are interested. They were found in the most ancient eras of even pre-dynastic civilization, had some of these stone vessels from basalt, from another stone called Bertia, from limestone, and from diorite, and from amethyst. And super finishing. Truly, it's still shining until today. Imagine, thousands of years passed on an artifact, had all kinds of withering underground, above ground, sun, water, sand, everything. And it's still shining. So these artifacts are one of the biggest question marks. The loads, tens of thousands, almost 40,000 or more than 40,000 pieces, were found stashed under the tunnels of the step pyramid of Zoser. And they were related to Zoser because they were found in the pyramid related to Zoser. Neter Ghet, this is the real name of Zoser. By the way, the word Zoser was only used from the Middle Kingdom. But the real writings of this king that was found in that structure is called Neter Ghet, means the divine body. And the vessels themselves, they had writings from the era known as the Archaic Age, which is the first and the second dynasty, and the Zero Dynasty. Now they also have something called Zero Dynasty. Why they relate them? Because some of them had writings or names of kings from this era. Like Hatshepsut and Din and many other names from the Archaic Age or the first and second. To be honest also, the writings that was found on these vessels, most of it is crude, like, you know, hardly scratches in the surface. But some of it is actually beautiful, very beautiful, to be honest, to have what's here and what's there. And the way the writings were put on these vessels is complicated, but it's not impossible. Because if you try to draw a line on a solid surface like these types of stones, because the tool that they used in the Archaic Age was not strong enough, so it slid on the surface and didn't create a beautiful depictions. And the other way to create this is to draw it, and then they used to make it point by point after they draw it. And that's complicated, but it was how they managed to have accurate writings added. And from the different scenes, like you see some of them, most of them is not even finished. And the most of the of them, they have crude writings. It's not so beautiful. Which we can say it's okay. They didn't develop the style of art as the dynastic started in the fourth dynasty and the fifth dynasty, especially the fifth dynasty. And we will compare another thing, which is what's in the ceiling of Dendera and what's in the Unas pyramid, the supposed to be the oldest pyramid text in that Winis pyramid in Saqqara. And the pyramid text in Winis, it was the first time, even if it was the first time to be written inside the pyramid, it's much older than that. And that's, I believe also, that the knowledge in the ceiling of Dendera is also much older than the Ptolemy era. Definitely, the whole temple, The last one. Because we find in Dendera tins of the place where they're supposed to write the name. Some people call it Khartoush, and the official name for it is called Shin, and we find tens of them empty, and just because some of the names were added in that era around 300 BC does not put the accurate timeline of the building itself. It can be older, but not much older. But the knowledge on the ceiling can be much, much older than the structure itself. If we compare, we find, for example, from another era called the Syncretic period, there is a vessel in the Egyptian Museum made from, they call it black granite, but it looks for me more like that to diorite or granodiorite. This vessel has very crude writings, and it reminds us of the same case on that beautiful artifact in the Serapeum, the giant books with the crude writings. So it's not far from Egyptology if I said that this vessel is Yousef from an older era, and somebody added the writings, and the timeline is giving a wrong timeline because they dated it based on writings that were added later.
Yousef, we are losing you a bit.
Of the vessel or of the basin. You're losing my voice?
Yeah, just anyway, lost few minutes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What I was saying is that what you find in the site period is similar like what you find in the Old Kingdom and the Archaic period. But the artifact itself, which is the vessel, exists from the pre-dynastic time. So the question is how did they make it in the pre-dynastic time? We're talking about different types of stones that not all of them are located in the same place. We talk about granite, we talk about porphyry, milky quartz, many, many different types, amethyst, diorite, and many others, slate. So in my opinion, it would be really hard for a pre-dynastic civilization to travel around this much to find these materials. Plus, the pottery manufacture itself was very, very primitive. How can you accomplish something so advanced with stone and in the same time you do something very primitive with pottery? That's like, there is a big question mark in this field, which also reflects back on the pyramid structure, because Flinders pottery proved since the end of the 18th century that these artifacts were made by what he called modern machining, or what we call ancient advanced machining, like the tubular drills and the saw.
Interesting thing to ask you is what is gravity, and how, for example, ancient Khemetians saw gravity and how they were calling it. And maybe you, Yousef, are, you know, familiar with Coral Castle and, you know, points of view towards, maybe you have some points of view towards Atlitskalnitz's work and how that is similar, his creation, to the buildings of Khemet, and what is the notion of gravity in ancient Khemet.
Yeah. Well, unfortunately, gravity is something we have like as a label today. And back in the days, how to find this or how to understand this is not most like it needs a research, like a special research to find its roots. You're talking, of course, about dynastic Egyptian time, and the idea is to have the rules of gravity by today's knowledge is different. And even if somebody is going to try to understand it from the ancient time, most of those who try to make the research are foreigners from this land. So none has been done. None of this research is not done yet, or it didn't begin yet, by Egyptians. Only if somebody came close to it, he will be a foreigner. So to understand that the mentality of the ancient Egyptians is still alive today. So that's why we can make more connection with the ancestors, more than any foreigner a person that would come and study. But the field, as I said, is too wide, and that subject especially needs a separate research for it, because so far we understand the capabilities, and in my opinion, there is more to the pyramid structure, especially the pyramid structure, than dynastic structures, or more than dynastic knowledge. So that's why I'm not going to look for gravity in dynasty because those who deal with anti-gravity are possibly from a pre-cataclysm time.
Yeah, that was exactly the thing I just wanted to ask you. Maybe they were in pre-dynastic times when they were able to live those megaliths, you know, in the same way we just can't, you know, just repeat today. So also, I'm not sure how familiar you are with Jesus Camara and his father's work, where they work in South America, where they are having the, also it's again the theory that maybe gravity in those times, in pre-dynastic Egyptian times too, was different, and maybe there were easier to lift those stones and work with such hard material then.
As I told you, the machining, far away from moving with giant blocks, the machining itself is reflecting something complicated.
Mm.
Complicated knowledge, not simple. But sometimes you can find this answer that will make it all like it was easy to be done. Same like some when we talk about the pyramid structure, and some of the officials mentions that the whole site or the most of the site is from local stones, as now that the challenge will be much easier, but it's not. And let's not forget also in the pyramid structure how the stones are interlocking, especially in the ground area. And that's, of course, is recognized by officials. But what is the theory? What is the explanation? Why would somebody go to these fine details and to this most complicated thing is to have each piece designed to interlock with not just one. It interlocks with three or four other, five sometimes, pieces around it. So that is something that reflects the mentality of the builder.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how we should look at it. Well, let's not judge the builders, even if they were from dynastic time or pre-dynastic. Let's not judge them to be primitive, because what they accomplished challenged us today.
Yeah, indeed. Absolutely.
Yeah, so how can we think of them as that they were less than us, and they accomplished something that I doubt that we can do today.
Mm.
Especially the pyramid is not just a giant structure. It has, you know, very complicated mathematics. We need to, you know, lots of... That's the mathematics of the pyramid.
Right. And of course, there's different theories on how it was cut or transported, of course. What do you think about the idea that they were able to soften the stone or material through certain mechanisms that maybe involved sound or water or, you know, electromagnetic, just the knowledge of the electromagnetic fields? Softening a stone. Do you know anything about that?
You know, we cut these hard stones today, and we don't need to soften the stones because we have the knowledge to cut it. We have the tools. If you have the tool, I think, again, it's the same thing. You think of a way to soften the stone because that primitive civilization can't accomplish it. So that's why you're going to think of an easy way.
I think it would be very...
Stone,
yeah.
You know what I mean? There is no evidence of stone was once in a liquid form and then hardened or something like that, or even... softened and then hardened. All the stones are like all the stone with the markings of machine shows the result of a very powerful tool. The tool itself was powerful to accomplish. You will be amazed of some of the things that was even accomplished by handy tools. So there are artifacts from granite, colossal piece, statues and everything made by hand, make no mistake. But we are talking about tool markings that didn't exist, supposedly.
Yeah.
But of course, according if we see the evidence, then 100% it did exist. Otherwise, what created these machine markings? But according to the all the timelines and all the like mankind evolution throughout the ages, so it only existed a short time ago. And this is the time when we started to recognize. We recognize this machine marking because we reached the level to understand. Then we saw it, but it was there all the time, even in the dynastic time. But when the dynastic Egyptians in the old kingdom displayed on the walls how to manufacture a vessel or vessels or vases and basins and stuff like that from this and not the very hard stones as well, they put a display of a way, a primitive way, if we can call it that. It includes drills, hammering, and polishing, everything. But it's not how it was done. It's not how these artifacts were done. If we're talking about the porphyry or the other types of hard stones like granite and like diorite, it was made by tubular drill. And this is, have no doubt about it, because unfinished pieces were found with the tubular core, the tubular drill core is still attached to the vessel. So there is no doubt that this is how it was done. Plus, we see this also in the temples, in the gateways, many times in slabs of stones sometimes, and then in unknown artifacts, like a big piece of basalt, and just people use it to hang their camels in the area, and it has a big marking of a tube drill in it. Very accurate. The process shows like a reflection of a power tool. This reflects a real power tool that was doing a powerful cut. There is you know, if you're doing this, there is a complete control on the tool, not complete, but on the tool itself to give this cut with this precision. And for example, the beginning of the tube drill is not giving a different shape than a circle. It is perfect circle. Everybody knows the existence of it, and we also know that it didn't exist. So let's say it like that. So far, nobody found a scene on the wall that exist like that, who looked like that, were using these tools. But can we date it right? Are there more intermediate periods for a time that they used to have this? That have this advanced technology? This is the mystery that's still not solved until today. This is a question that nobody could give a final answer. Same like nobody could give you a last answer about how did the ancient build it. Because they talk about this era and the only the existence of copper chisels, so they want to limit how this was done, which then makes it doesn't sound professional at all. Like one of the series about industrials, how the granite stone was not quarried out of the bedrock in the old kingdom. This is more than one source officially believes this, and I disagree with that. This is one of the things I disagree with in the official books, that all the granite stone in the old kingdom was not hacked out of the bedrock because they think they didn't have the tools. So they must have found these pieces falling aside or loose so they could use it. That again, is a theory probably made by historians, and I don't think professionals or like engineers will agree with this, or geologists, because the layers of granite, as Susan Moore taught us, that some of the stones is brought from very deep parts of the quarry, not from the surface. And this is the finest types of granite is used in the pyramid structures. Plus, not one structure in all the pyramids here that you find a pillar. Sometimes the pillar is like almost 6 meter high, and you find like in the open court 16 pillars, and they're all from single solid pieces. Where do you find 16 pieces of granite Plus that they shaped them all like the palm shape. Doesn't this reflect that those who did this, they had complete control?
Yeah.
They, exactly what they were doing, making 60 pillars of rose granite from single solid pieces. The one is around between five and a half or six meters.
Yeah.
That is like something we cannot dismiss here. Same like thinking the bent pyramid is a mistake.
Mm-hmm.
The ancient Egyptians. How come? But if you didn't say this, then who is Sinefru? And why would he build more than one pyramid? Can we really relate this to Sinefru? That's another question. Because all the new researches about the bent pyramid, everybody knows that this must have been designed to look like that exactly. It's not a random work. It's not improvised. This is, you know, and of course, it's much better to ask architect engineers about this. They understand the challenges, of course, better than I do. But I heard from many. And a pyramid structure is not something that you just bring the stone and think what to do with it. You must have a plan, a very strong plan, especially for repairing the bedrock to house this structure. You know exactly how much you're going to put up there above and how much you're going to connect it to that bedrock. It's not like you just start, because the connection between the bedrock and the pyramid structure is obviously measured and figured out before they start the pyramid structure. And many examples like this. So we talked about like the bent pyramid in the Ashur and many other things. Maybe one example to see, so also in the official books, they say, so in the Middle Kingdom, they started to evolve and they cut the granite from the bedrock. But if you looked at the facts, they started recycling from the stone widely in the Middle Kingdom. And the most famous example is the pyramid of Elisht. Elisht is a location that was chosen, as the official book says, by the Middle Kingdom to make their capital. And they call it Ithittawi, the one that unifies or the one that captures the two lands. And the pyramid there, and this is also discovered by Egyptologists, it's not like something that I discovered myself. No, I read it in Egyptology books, that the pyramid was had recycled stones to renovate it. And this recycled, the stone that was reused was from all the kingdom structures because they recognized writing from the old kingdom on it. And it was reused again to build the whole pyramid of Elisht. But maybe the pyramid was there and it was just a renovation. And this is something you can realize that there, throughout the ages, those who inherit the sites, they can run the site or use the site itself, and they can use it as a quad. So if they're gonna use the site itself to activate it, to make it a church or to make it a temple or to make it a city or whatever, then they start to renovate the structures in it. And like us, if we use it as a tourist attraction, for example. And if they're not going to do that, then they use it as a quarry. And that's a very, very common thing. And also renovation at the sites is a very common thing from the oldest time, from the New Kingdom. Sometimes you find good examples. And I believe it can also go much further than that.
Yeah. It's really mind-blowing. You know, all their lifestyle was so prefinged and so organized, like even their vases, like, you know, we see they were so very perfectly shapely, you know, cut and everything. And also another thing which is really mind-boggling to me is, like, people are saying that, you know, the building of pyramids was some kind of the slavery, and, you know, they have been having slaves and all the rest of the people to build them. But for me, exactly, it's not a slavery, it's more like celebration and honor to be able to build that. Because if we will look into the mastery of the machining and the sophistication and the way they carefully used energy, it is foolish to think that Khemitians could allow slavery in the first place. Like, imagine what kind of distorted energy would be if slaves would build structures controlled by fear and pain. And, you know, could such a structure last so long then? You know, we see that pyramids last thousands upon thousands of years, and you know, so how based upon that fear, structures couldn't be, you know, standing so long. So that's first reason, maybe.
Yeah, definitely nobody else could accomplish something like what the pyramid builders era could.
Yeah.
So how come? If they evolved in the Middle Kingdom, why did they start to quarry stones wider, in a wider scale in the Middle Kingdom? If they already evolved, then they're the ones who are hacking the bedrock for granite and for other solid stones. And then on the other hand also, like how come, about slavery, where is the, give me one solid proof to talk about this slavery. The scenes we see and on the walls, they depict war prisoners, not slaves. There is not one scene that shows people working as slaves. No, not one.
Mm-hmm.
You got people working and people playing music in the other side. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like in the same scene. You got people like dragging a huge statue, like the one in El Bersha, for example. And they're all dressed like, you know, like celebration. Hmm?
Yeah.
That's what's in these scenes. But it is very rare to find scenes for building a structure. But the timeline doesn't fit with the story. I think the story of the slaves is a famous agenda, and we don't believe it here for a second. It's just many people have agendas. It's like the aliens thing.
Yeah. It's just the same, like, you know, measurement tool. Like, people are thinking that maybe if today such you know, monuments were building, they can't even think about any other reason but just slavery, you know, according to the mentality we're in now. So we can just even imagine that, you know, those different times were different and we could accomplish through love and that collaboration together instead of slavery.
Yes. And it's the same case also why I disagree with the story or the idea or whatever it is, whoever brought that story about that during the time of the flood, they took the farmers to work in the pyramid. Can you take a farmer to do a stonemason work today? I don't think so.
Mm-hmm.
The farmer works something and the stonemasonry work is something else. So you don't just bring the farmers to do other people's job. These people were trained in the temple. I'm not talking about the pyramid builders again, but I'm talking about dynastic Egyptians, because you will be amazed that how the dynastic Egyptians in the Old Kingdom and the Middle Kingdom and the New Kingdom, how much mathematic and the art and the tools and the experience they had. It was unbelievable to create a scene on a box or on a wall of a temple. They used to have a technical drawing, basically, where they would draw horizontal and vertical lines to lay out the glyphs and the scenes with the golden ratio and with the highest of mathematics that would challenge, I will say this, would challenge anybody today to do it. The measurement was so accurate. And I'm talking dynastic Egyptians. I'm talking the tombs, the temples from the Old Kingdom time and until the Greco-Roman time. It was all done by Egyptians. We only live with Greco-Roman because there is a name of a Greco-Roman person in the cartouche. But we understand that all the art and all the construction was done by Egyptians. Seem like the same case in the Coptic era and in the Islamic era. Most of these structures appeared and from stone appeared in Egypt, but the Islamic civilization, or the, not the Islamic, but the Arab civilization didn't have the idea of a tomb, for example, built from stone. This is the influence of the Egyptian culture on the Islamic and on the Coptic and on the Greek, Roman and Persians. Everybody who interacted with Egypt, they had the influence of our civilization because it was very rich and very powerful, especially the Greeks. We all know about Pythagoras, how, where he learned, Solon, Plato, all the philosophers, they received their knowledge in the Egyptian temples.
Yeah, it's also very interesting that everything is upside down today. You know, like I just also sent you the picture in the plot, like in Chris Dunn, he did investigation, and according to Chris Dunn, you know, Khemitians were driving the earth to divine harmony, to the relieving of seismic pressures through the pyramids. And also he were talking about the system of the power plant, and, you know, he called those air shafts in the Giza pyramid, he called them microwave signal inputs. And we see that they are going upwards, like expanding and relieving, spreading the energy, like upwards. And what today we see in the, for example, prism picture, like we have how light breaks, it breaks up, you know, to the downsides, just like breaks not upside down, but down, and it just compresses and preserves and keeps, you know, that energy. So everything is upside down these days, instead of just sharing like Egyptians did and ancient Khemitians did, that through that energy relieving and expanding, we now do compressing, and we just can't understand those things because of that, how they were able to do that expansion. What's your points of view here?
Yeah, well, of course, Christopher Dunn, our teacher and friend, he has a very unique way to see these structures, especially as a power plant. And for me, I feel it and I see it as a, also not just the pyramid structure, but sometimes activations can happen on much smaller scale. And it's all connected to bioenergy, in my opinion. How was this like functioning as a device to feed mankind, especially when you get the water running through it. I talked with many people on the sites also, when we talk about what's labeled as a sewer system, but it looks, it was like functional all the time, and these structures were in the tip of water of the river. And of course, the possibility of the pyramid dragging water to the spot itself, or that it was already built on a water table, or part of it was used as a pump to elevate water. Definitely, we have water and we have magnetic energy. And this is, where are the studies about this that the, like, normal people like me can reach? There is none. There is none as real experiments. There is more theories. So if we really understand, there is, in my opinion, there is only one way, which is experimenting. We need to do more experiments. And to understand the more, we need many knowledgeable people to come together as geologists and alchemists, physicists, and definitely, many are in the pyramid structure. But if we have something like this functional and activated, it's definitely can be everything our world is looking for to be. It can lead to finding results about health and how we can live healthy. It can give us results about free energy if we need it, like the way we use it, like electricity. And it also can be the cure for Earth, for Mother Earth, from all the pollution that we're giving to this, to the land we're living on, because we are not in tune with Mother Nature. We are not like the ancient, even talking like the Indian people or the Egyptian people in the dynastic time, or all the like Native Americans, or how did everybody learn it from nature and based his, like, tuned himself into the cycles, not creating another system based on like explosions, and there is exhaust, and there is pollution to the waters, petrochemical medicine, all these things. Like, maybe the research of the pyramid power or activation or can lead us to solve some of the very, very important and needed answers for lots of the problems we live in, and maybe more will come. So it can be a solution for many things. But none of these experiments, like people in the 60s, in the 70s, some, you know, if somebody started back then, we should have results by now. We should come far. But we are still, you know, researching in mythology and or like in theories. We are still talking theories more than experimenting. That's what to if we need to. But the battle is, or like the game is like that. We need to prove first that there is more to the pyramid than being a tomb, and this is still the challenge we are facing until today, that we didn't pass this. We still have to prove that the pyramid is more than just a tomb, or even if it was as a tomb, it could have been used for something else. And we understand the alignment. Like, some people did, of course, small experiments on the shape only. The shape of the pyramid is the angle, and then they align it with the true north, and then they will get an activation. This is just a very limited part of the research, because if it's just the shape, if the shape only gives you this activation, then what about the rest of the elements? We still need to look at and how did the fusion happen between all these elements, and what is the result of that? And as I said, in my opinion, this will only come with experiment.
Yeah, I agree. Another curious thing is early explorers tell us that the interior of the Queen's Chamber was molded with salt up to an inch thick. Now, why would that be? We don't find it in other parts of the pyramid, or at least not that much. What do you think?
I've never seen pictures of this. And but I have another, but I have seen the salt glaze in other structures, right, Patricia? Like the one, for example, in the Red Pyramid and in Maidun Pyramid. There's big, thick layers of salt glaze. And this can happen naturally. It's being shed out of the limestone blocks as like first forms, as like fuzzy salt, you know, coming just out of the wood, and then layer after layer after layer, it becomes this solid thick one. So it can happen naturally, but it could be also that the activation can create it to happen faster. So we cannot be positive again until we do experiments. Yet some people did the experiment about the pyramid and how it can affect crops and the plants. And sometimes the result is like the pyramid power can create, like they can cause these plants to grow two or three times bigger or faster than the normal ones. So there is no doubt that we touched something, how that the fruits wouldn't get rotten, and how the milk wouldn't get rotten, and the sharp, the blade would become sharper, and all these simple things. But this happened, I think, in the 60s or the 70s. We should have gone, you know, straight with this further. But nobody is experimenting. There is nothing new. It's all based on individuals. They do this test. And sometimes if they discover something, they will have to prove it to the system, and they wouldn't know what's happening. They realize that there is an activation, but they cannot give the
scientific explanation.
Yeah, the explanation of it. So,
yeah.
So yeah. Where is the systems research? Hmm? Where is the Egyptian science, or the American, or any other country in the world? Because this can be, you know, something useful for everybody. We just learned something about the pyramid power, about purification, or it can heal diseases, and things like that. So sacred geometry definitely is used. And we have, of course, famous people here in Egypt who reached the very high levels with sacred geometry, like, what's his name? Karim. Hmm?
Yeah. Well, yeah, absolutely. There are several people that have done many studies on the sacred geometrical.
Ibrahim Karim, I think
his name. That does sound familiar. But yeah. So many different, you know, not just within the pyramid structure, but the Giza Plateau itself. But that's actually how everything in this earth, everything grows. Life grows in sacred geometric patterns. So if whoever built these structures with their amazing ability to make perfect alignments and, you know, the perfection of the structure itself, and as Yousef explained, even, you know, the technology to create it, if they have this capability, they certainly are going to create within, you know, the dynamic of how things grow themselves, in my opinion.
Yeah. One specific example of this geometry and the healing powers of it was in one YouTube video where Yousef was explaining the niches and the stones and the niches and the stones, how accurately they are cut into some of these structures, and he was telling the story how the physician would stand in one of the niches and a potential patient, you know, would stand somewhere else in the structure, and they would exchange that way energy, and would heal and exchange you know, frequencies. Can you tell a little bit about that?
That's actually at the hospital. We call it the hospital. Hakeem called it the hospital at the site of Saqqara. And there are structures, the niches in the walls, that are attached by underground tunnels to what there's one still standing, a patient's table, where the patient, there were two sets of steps up into this huge platform. And it speaks to the polarity. One would be masculine, one would be feminine. And they would go up to the platform, and the physician, or, you know, I would call it the Imhotep, the one who understood the energetics, the energetic architecture of the body, of the structure of the body, would place his head in this niche. And it is said that he could actually see the physical, the energetic structure of the patient, and see where the energy fields were blocked. And then he would be able to play, you know, send a tone, a frequency, and even a color that would unblock this blockage to create the balance again, to recreate this balance within the body. And again, which would, of course, result in health.
Yeah, and I think a lot of these temples have these sweet spots.
Mentioned about this structure officially, and the rest we try to imagine how it functions, but there is nothing written about it in the ancient times. But it was known to be used as a healing place, even officially. It's known.
Yeah,
maybe I cannot explain what happens, but I definitely feel it when we go to the Giza Plateau.
Yeah, it's not words that I use.
Some people say it's about ionizing the field, and the more negative ionization is healthier for the body or something like that. I heard that, but even if I cannot understand the official, like the scientific explanation, but there is no doubt that I feel it when I go.
Yeah.
This nobody, I don't have to, for this part especially, like when we do toning or something like that, I'm not gonna like even, you know, even with the accurate and the hard evidence in our hand, and we still have lots of arguments, and we still have lots of doubts and some things, and you know, but even something like this, I'm not gonna take it to as a research, but I use it, or like I became familiar with it, I enjoy it, and I feel it. Nobody can convince me that there is nothing happening.
Yeah,
because I feel it.
If you experience, you know it.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know it.
There's no words to describe it. But certainly, I hear that from other people too that go visit, temples or structures all over the world, that they find under a certain arch or whatever, just a certain sweet spot where they either, you know, see colors or can talk to people that are far away, standing, you know, maybe up to like, 100 meters, 50 meters in the same structure, but they would hear them clearly speaking from this sweet spot. So that there's something to be said about that. Yeah, a lot of people can feel it still today, so that tells us something.
Absolutely.
Yes, I feel it in my body. My body becomes lighter, more energized. Even after a day in the Giza Plateau, you should be coming home wasted, literally, after hiking and going down tunnels and all
this. Climbing pyramids, and we come back totally energized.
We come home totally energized. We can talk and we do this and do that. And you can still, you still feel this dose in your body for almost a week after that. And then you feel also that it's gone. And when you go
and
back
you
again,
you want to go back.
When you go back again, you find that you received it again. So that's how I got like some, the awareness of my body got, became aware of it without explanations. I just, the body recognized something. Same like when you're thirsty and you drink water, you just know it. It's not, it's not something supernatural. It's very natural.
Very natural.
Yeah,
I just like how Muhammad Ibrahim just shared, like, in the pyramids, especially in Giza pyramids, people are witnessing the cell renewal process. Like after teenage, body of adult cannot renew all brain cells, you know, and they are fully developed, after that age. But somehow being in the great chamber, cells of brain start to renew itself again. So, that's also interesting.
So many things can happen in that pyramid. We've witnessed so many different events. And it's always, it doesn't really blow our minds anymore, but it's amazing to recognize that this energy within it that's still active. You know, can you imagine what it would have been like when it was really in its prime?
Yeah.
You know, with its casing stone and the whole plateau working.
Yeah.
You know, I can't even imagine what it might have. I can imagine.
Before at least 4,000 years of quarry.
Wow.
And it's still active. And that's another thing, you know, I will say if it's obvious that a site like the Giza Plateau was being used as a quarry for more than 4,000 years. And I'm talking officially, I'm not talking something like my own research, but officially it was being used for more than 4,000 years as a quarry.
Yeah. Mind blowing.
And officially also, it's less than 100 years to build every pyramid on the Giza. How is this? Everything. I'm talking about all the pyramids, not just the Great Pyramid.
Exactly.
Everything supposed to be on the Giza Plateau was built in 100 years. And it's been used as a quarry for 4,000 years, and we didn't take even 10% of the stone. I'm not going to be exaggerating. We didn't take 10% of the stone that's in there, no matter how much all the eras took from it.
Hmm. Incredible.
Yeah.
Indeed. Yeah. Well, man, even though we had some technological difficulties, I think we have covered quite some ground. And it's a wonderful energy having you both on. We would like to continue that with you And I think we've built a ground here, maybe for part three of our series with you guys. And I'm just blown away from all this stuff. It's you know, it's almost the energy swapping over from you guys since and of course we're still looking forward to meet you one day and experience it ourselves with you.
That would be the best thing.
It has to happen.
Talking about these people, then I can show you. And being at the site and showing you, it's gonna be
entirely different experience.
Yes, and it's gonna be easier for me to bring to your like sight and awareness some things. Like, really, when you look at the structure and feel it and be in it and recognize the challenges, it's not hard to decide then that to know that those builders were really knowledgeable and not like primitive people with copper chisels and what the officials sometimes would want us to feel about the ancient Egyptians.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, great. Wow. So all I can say at this point is to be continued. Thank you so much
that we were able to
have you.
Thank you for having us.
Yeah, and wish you so much fun and luck in your undertakings and the upcoming tours, of course. And we'll be watching and connect with you soon again. So, thanks again, and have a wonderful evening.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
We look forward to it. Thanks.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
It's more simple here in Egypt. Freedom for people here is to find a decent food to eat and a good place to sleep. That's it. It's not about like I want the right to protest or anything. The revolution didn't happen just to have the right to protest. The people fed up of suffering all the time. And the Egyptian people especially are the best survivors. Like for ages we've been, okay, it's getting worse in this way, so let's just go to this way and, you know, trying to live with the circumstances. Until it came to a point where people cannot find food anymore. And that's where we have to stand up. Hmm? Like we have this famous saying, if evil comes to you while you are standing, you gotta sit down. And if it came to you when you are sitting down, lean. If it came to you when you are leaning, sleep. But if it came to you while you are sleeping, then you have to stand up again, you know? This is, so we did all the steps and we slept for 30 years. And then it came to us even there. So they had to stand up. It's not like just an ancient saying, it's an energy combination, because the Egyptian people, they put these phrases based on like it's energy. You know, you're gonna have a limit after you do all this. When you rise, after you've done all the steps of like standing and then sitting and then leaning and then laying, you have nothing else except standing or you're gonna die. So as survivors, we keep trying just to go on and on and on until we really don't find a way, and then you will have to stand up because it's like your last stand. And as everyone saw, like in Tahrir Square, which I have been there myself, the people, the Egyptian people, of course I can't say 100%, but most of them has the most warm hearts on earth. And I have seen other nations and I have seen the Egyptian, and I know how we are like really, just in this moment, you walk with hundreds of thousands of people and you don't know each other, but you do know each other. It's not like strangers walking around with each other. No, we all know each other somehow. There is something and like that drives all this amount of people in harmony. No one told us what to do in these days, but somehow we all know. Like some kind of download came to everyone's mind, and they know how to get really united in a very good way. With lots of course,
like the system tried to put this bad energies in between, and still. So the way for freedom is, it's a long path and it has lots of suffering. But I will tell you, the people had little demands in the beginning. And then the system, not just in Egypt, in every other country, when the system start to use violence and the people see other dead people, that's when we know that there is no way back. We have to keep going. Like if the system give to the people some labels of freedom, like the very few things, and peace and food. And these two words in ancient Egypt had one label. Peace and food were labeled as hotib. It meant both of them. So with peace and food, we feel that we have freedom. It's not so complicated. Because it's not about like I want to control something, then I feel my freedom. I just want to be on my own and living my life, not harming anyone and not having anyone harming me. That's it. It's that simple. Yeah.